Hi, I'm Bill Maxwell, Director of Product Management for the Rancher platform here at SUSE. And I've been in the Kubernetes ecosystem now for several years. Been with Rancher pretty much since the beginning, and so I've been in the container ecosystem for quite a while. And today I'd like to talk about enabling consistent Kubernetes cluster operations across your environment everywhere. And so today I'd like to talk about consistent cluster operations and why that's important for your organization as you embrace Kubernetes. I'm going to talk about some of the challenges and pitfalls you could run into, and then we'll talk about a strategy to implement to avoid those pitfalls, and then we'll take a look at a demo of a potential solution to all of those challenges. So why are we talking about consistent cluster operations today? Well, as your organization's embracing Kubernetes, it's probably to help you deliver software to multiple different locations, whether you're using it as a strategy to move from on-premise to the cloud, whether you're taking your applications and moving them to your branch offices or some smaller device, you're gonna run Kubernetes and you wanna be able to deliver applications as quickly and safely as possible. And so Kubernetes is a great tool for that, but it does require some strategies as you embrace it to make sure that it delivers on that promise. And so what you're gonna wanna do is stamp out each Kubernetes cluster to be the same, right? You're gonna want your dev, test, and production environments all to look very, very similar and have a very consistent path from your development environments to your production environments. And so to accomplish that, you're gonna need automation in place to make sure that you're building consistent clusters regardless of where they are. And then you're gonna need to have operations elements for each of these clusters. You're gonna have to upgrade, you're gonna have to scale your Kubernetes clusters, and you're going to need to do backups in the case something bad happens and you have to recover from a previous state. And ultimately, because you're going to have a lot of clusters potentially, you're going to want to have a single place to go to view that the health and the status of each of those clusters. You're going to want that single pane of glass in order to be able to operate all of your clusters regardless of where they're running. Organizations that are embracing Kubernetes often have different environments in which they run, and they have different goals in what they're trying to accomplish. And so Kubernetes can run anywhere. And so you just have to be able to make sure that you're picking the right solution for the environment that you're operating in. So you can be running Kubernetes on-premise or start there and have it as part of your strategy to deliver applications quickly. You could use it to move to the cloud. And there you have different choices. You could run your own Kubernetes clusters on VMs, or you could leverage the hosted cloud providers' managed Kubernetes services. There's trade-offs to each, but both really viable solutions as you go to the cloud. And then you might experience so much success with Kubernetes that you want to deliver applications to even more places using Kubernetes. And so whether that's branch offices, cell phone towers, windmills, satellites, the back of trucks with small compute farms in the back, Kubernetes is really going everywhere. And so each one of them has a different way of provisioning and getting a Kubernetes cluster. And so you're going to want to make sure that as you embrace Kubernetes, you have the tooling in place and the operations in place to do the backups and scalability and upgrading and a way to just maintain those clusters over time. And so because Kubernetes can run everywhere, you have a lot of choices when you go to deliver Kubernetes in those environments. And in the ecosystem, there's 67 Kubernetes distributions, 48 hosted Kubernetes platforms, and 21 different Kubernetes installers. So wherever you're running, you have options. But if you go down this do-it-yourself path, you're potentially becoming an integrator yourself, because you're going to need to write automation around each one of these provisioning tools. If you're picking like a specialized one for on-prem versus a managed provider, you're gonna need to have a way to do backups. You're gonna have to do, how are you gonna scale? And all of this is doable, but your operations teams are gonna be taking on more and more of an operational burden on dealing with these separate different processes for building out these Kubernetes clusters. And so as you're looking to run these Kubernetes systems in multiple places, you wanna make sure that you're focusing on solutions that'll kind of tie a few of them together for you, and so that you're not the one that has to necessarily do all of the integrations bits, because there's a lot of choices and a lot of flexibility in how you run these clusters everywhere. The CNCF ecosystem is booming. There's lots of tools out there to help you But just keep in mind that, you know, the more that you're doing yourself to kind of glue these pieces together, potentially the more operational burden your teams are going to have. And the other challenge is, as you embrace different tools in different environments, you end up with sort of a fractured view of the world. You're going to the cloud portal to look at your hosted Kubernetes solution. You're going to your on-premise virtualization platform to look at the VM health of those clusters. And you're going to a Kubernetes dashboard, which could be multiple, you know, to view what's going on in the Kubernetes clusters. And so you have these different panes of glass that you need to, you know, keep in mind and visit in order to operate these clusters. And it's also, you know, your end users of the Kubernetes clusters are going to need access to these systems, and how do you manage who has access to these different environments? It potentially adds a lot of overhead to your environment. And then as you're automating out these environments, you know, you're dealing with multiple APIs. And so each automation is its own integration and its own effort. You know, so that's just something to keep in mind as you're going down this path of running Kubernetes everywhere in your environment, that it's easy to end up with multiple views of the same thing. So we've been talking about a few of the pitfalls and challenges of do-it-yourself solutions, or, you know, running Kubernetes across multiple environments, and all of the available tools, and how you would have to kind of pull these together to achieve a consistent set of operations for your Kubernetes clusters in every environment that you're going to be operating in. And so what I'd like to do now is talk about a potential solution to realizing consistent Kubernetes cluster operations. So how do we achieve consistent cluster operations? We want to have that automation layer. So we want to have something that provides a consistent provisioning API, because you're going to most likely be running on-premise in a virtualized environment or bare metal. You're going to be running in the cloud, again, with virtual machines, or on a hosted or managed Kubernetes solution. Or, you know, you could just be running on a small edge device in a branch office, you know, that's like a Raspberry Pi. And so when you are doing that, you're going to want to have a way to normalize the operation, so you're not writing a separate integration for every location that you're going to be running in. And you're going to want something that helps with the day-to-day operations. And so a tool like Rancher provides a consistent provisioning API and a consistent distribution of Kubernetes that enables you to do backups and manage that all through a single pane of glass, which makes it very powerful in being able to, you know, ensure that you're consistently deploying, managing, and operating your Kubernetes clusters the way that you would expect, and without adopting a lot of operational burden. So now that we have clusters across all our environments provisioned the way we want them to, backed up and scanned for security, you know, the next layer up is how do we ensure a consistent set of security policy? How do we ensure a set of applications are running on these Kubernetes clusters to enable infrastructure as code, or Gitops in the Kubernetes ecosystem? And so a tool like Azure Arc for Kubernetes really helps here, because it brings all of your Kubernetes clusters to your Azure portal. And so if you've been operating in Azure for a long time, this is just a natural extension of the tooling and operations that you've already got in place, but for Kubernetes. It also allows you to apply policies to your clusters and managing that at scale. It brings in GitOps tools so you can deploy your applications in a consistent way across your environment. And it also gives you a centralized control plane, that single pane of glass, to visualize all of your clusters and the applications and policies being applied to them. And so when you bring the two stacks together, they're quite complementary, because you now have full stack visibility of all of your Kubernetes clusters. You have consistent policy applied to each of them. You have consistent set of automation tooling that enables you to provision, upgrade, scale out, and back up all of your Kubernetes clusters. You can do monitoring and logging of all of your applications and your Kubernetes clusters into Azure. And you get workload management, a consistent way to deploy those applications through GitOps. And so now you have a fully automated stack for your Kubernetes environments, and you're able to just have this nice consistent set of operations and a consistent, easy way to do things across the Kubernetes environment. And so now I'd like to take you through a demo of what this solution looks like. And so we'll start with provisioning a cluster. We will upgrade that cluster through automation. And then we will take a look at some of the operational elements that are available to you. And then we will add one of those clusters to Azure Arc for Kubernetes and deploy an application to it through Gitops.
Okay, let's take a look at a demo of installing Rancher or installing a Kubernetes cluster within Rancher. So here we're going to use Terraform as our infrastructure as code to provision a new cluster on vSphere. And so in the lower right hand corner, you'll see that I've got the Terraform module. Above is the web UI of the Rancher platform. And on the left, we're going to do our Terraform apply. Now I'm going to speed up the replay speed as it takes a while to provision. So here, behind the scenes, what's happening is we're creating a node pool for the Rancher, the Kubernetes control plane, and a node pool for the worker nodes. And so all in total, we'll have four nodes in this cluster. We're provisioning, and you can see that we're pulling down all the available images and bringing the cluster up to speed. Then the nodes are starting to register, and we've deployed our agent so that the agent can register the cluster back into Rancher. Now that the cluster has gone active, you'll see it is now able to be used within Rancher, and so you can perform operations on it or, you know, take a look at what's going on in the cluster. So you'll notice here that I've installed Kubernetes 1.17. Now, it's common that you'll want to upgrade Kubernetes versions as they come out. And so let's go through what that looks like. On the lower right-hand corner, I'm editing my Terraform module so that I can upgrade the Kubernetes version to 1.18. Now I will apply that through Terraform. And you can see that as it's going, it's now being applied. The first thing that happens is it pulls all the images, it updates the control node, and then it'll update each of the worker nodes one at a time to minimize the impact to your running applications. You can see it takes a few minutes to do this, but it's still going through and updating each one of these nodes one at a time so that they can be brought up. You'll now see that we're now running Rancher is reporting Kubernetes 1.18 for that cluster. Let's take a look at the live system and see what kind of operations we can perform. So I'm going to edit this cluster. And here you can see I've created my two node pools, one for the control plane and one for the worker nodes. And I can select different Kubernetes versions, and so I could upgrade from here if I chose to. But down here in the advanced options, you can see a few more of the operational elements of the cluster. Here, I can configure my backups for etcd. Right now, we're taking local backups that are reoccurring every 12 hours, and we're keeping six of them. We can also back these, store these backups in an S3 compatible storage. We can also then set up security scans on our cluster. So we can periodically scan our cluster and ensure that we're configured as we expect, so within the confines of the CIS benchmark. So these are just a couple of the operational elements that you can do. Other things like rotating the certificates in the cluster are also possible. And there's a lot that you can accomplish. But let's take a look now at registering a cluster into Azure Arc. The first thing we're going to do is register the provider for Kubernetes. So we'll run a couple commands and verify that we've registered. So now we are registered with the Azure Arc. Next, we're going to connect our Kubernetes cluster to Azure Arc. And so you can see I'm running the AZ command here. And it's being connected in. Now what's happening behind the scenes is Azure is deploying a Helm chart onto my cluster. We're deploying some application to connect it back into the Azure portal. So you can see it's created an Azure Arc namespace, and it's done a few deployments into that namespace to connect back in and control different elements of the cluster. So now we can take a look at adding an application through Gitops. This is one of the more powerful features of Azure Arc for Kubernetes, is the ability to deploy applications and apply Kubernetes manifest through infrastructure as code. This is all doable from the Azure Arc portal, and so we'll go through a demo of that. And so here, I'm adding in the configuration. I'm going to pick the namespace that it's going to deploy the application to. I'm going to get the URL of our repository and set it to public. I'm going to set it to cluster scope and then add that configuration. So now you can see I can check some status. I get a message from the cluster. I refresh that, and if I go to the cluster and through kubectl, I can see that I have a container being created in the cluster config namespace, as I said. You can see that there's a few deployments that are coming online. And in a few moments, we'll see that the cluster will communicate back up to the Azure portal and register the application installed. And so now, what we've seen here is an application being the full stack. Our cluster is provisioned and managed and upgraded, through one common control plane through Rancher. And then we can use the Azure Arc for Kubernetes portal to deploy applications, policy, and other things onto the cluster. And so this is a really powerful set of tools at your disposal. And I hope you'll take a deeper look on your own time.
So I just wanted to say thank you. Today we've talked about consistent Kubernetes cluster operations and how we can accomplish that using Rancher and Azure Arc. If you have any follow-on questions, please reach out to azure@suse.com and we'll get back to you with the answers as quick as we can. Thank you.